much. We again, if everyone's sitting comfortably, if I can welcome you all to today's Transport Committee. First item, as always, is apologies for absence. Apologies from Jimmy Jackson.
That's all about it.
And Dennis Paul was hurt his hand as well, so he's had to go to hospital. So we can send our very best wishes to Dennis for a speedy recovery. I suppose whilst we're talking about those people that have been waylaid with medical reasons, we should also take the opportunity to extend our best wishes both to Shane Fitzpatrick, Senior Head of Service, because he's currently recovering from some surgery, and also Dil Masters, the Head of Service for Asset Management, is currently sort of struggling with a problem. So if we can record our very best wishes for speedy recoveries for both of those. And just in the interest of completeness, being asked just to sort of formally mark that Michelle Keating, who was our previous Head of Democratic Services, who usually would be sat up at the front overseeing proceedings, Michelle's left the organisation. She's gone to what sounds like a very exciting opportunity for her and her family in Cornwall, but obviously she's been a key part of this committee and this organisation for many, many years, so it would be sort of nice and fitting and appropriate if we just record our sort of thanks to her for all her efforts and give her and her family all of our very best wishes in their new endeavours, if we can record all of those things accordingly. Second item is declarations of interest, which is just the usual reminder. If there is anything now or any time during the committee's proceedings, please don't hesitate to notify us accordingly. Third item is the minutes of the last meeting. And can I move that those are a correct record? But there may be other points, Steve?
Just to highlight to members on page 9, comment about cycle tracks with autos. The issue I was trying to raise was because of the different sources of funding, you can often have a brand new cycle track built alongside a road that has autos and that confuses members of the public. So if the minutes could reflect the point that we're trying to get across, better. Much appreciated.
Yeah, we can record that correction appropriately. And with that included, can I sort of move that the minutes of the 7th of June be approved as a correct record, if that's agreed? Excellent. Okay, to the more substantive items. For new members, we regularly invite some of the different transport operators to present to us and give us an opportunity to question them on their activities and their plans for the future of delivering services in the region. Obviously, as all members will be aware, it's been what I'll very politely call a challenging time on the City Lines. The rail service is principally delivered by Northern Rail. So because of that, and following a motion that we took at the committee meeting on the 7th of June, we requested that sort of Craig Harrop from Northern comes along today to give us a presentation about where Northern is currently up to, and obviously give the committee the full sort of comprehensive opportunity to ask any questions and get those detailed responses from Craig. So, Craig, thank you for coming along this afternoon, and if I can hand over to yourself first to give your presentation.
Thanks, Liam. Good afternoon, everybody. For those that don't know, I'm Craig Harrop, I'm the interim provisional director for this part of the world. I think before I begin, I'd like to apologise for the unacceptable challenging situation and disruption that our customers and many passengers have faced travelling in and out of the city region and indeed the wider northwest. We're truly sorry for this, and we are working extremely hard to rectify that as an industry but also as an individual train operator. What I want to do today is talk a bit about how we got in this situation in the first place, what we've done to tackle the problems, what we're doing in the immediate future, and then looking a little bit further ahead into beyond December. I'll also touch on the compensation scheme that was announced this week for all our customers in the north. And all this information will be available on our website, is available on our website. And then I'll take any questions that you may have following that. So first of all, just a bit of background. I think I'm right in saying that the May timetable change, particularly in the north, was going to be the biggest transformation in railway timetables since the tracks were laid. The plan was to completely modernise and transform the service with additional capacity, newer trains and additional services, up to 2,000 extra services. That plan was completely and utterly predicated on the delivery of two bits of infrastructure, one between Manchester and Preston via Bolton, the electrification of that line, and the Blackpool to Preston line, which I'll come on to in a little while. So the electrification of that route was key for us, so we could introduce new electric trains. We have 12 new electric trains waiting to occupy that route, and that would then release other diesel trains to provide the extra services in the northwest, further afield, right across the north. Because we didn't have that infrastructure to run our electric trains, we simply couldn't have enough trains to develop and deliver the full timetable. Now, Network Rail told us about the delays to the Manchester to Preston route in January, after we had already planned our timetable, planned all the train related to that timetable, as well as all the additional services and train diagrams. So what that meant, normally a timetable of this magnitude would take up to a year to plan, and effectively that's what it did. We had to replan that very same timetable in the space of 4 months, which has never been done before, and because of that, it didn't really go through the rigorous testing and assessment that a timetable of that size would, simply because Network Rail didn't have the time to do that, and neither did we. Excuse me. We recognised that this was going to be a massive challenge, and the revised timetable that we had to put in would creak and would be an issue, and we made representations to that effect, with a view to just rolling forward the current timetable and not putting any changes in at all. That was rejected, unfortunately, by the industry, and we had to go ahead with this quickly developed timetable. The next piece of infrastructure that we needed to deliver our additional services, deliver our new electric trains, was the section between Blackpool and Preston. So this piece of work should have been completed before Easter, and we had a training plan in place to deliver the necessary training and get the timetable in for that point in time. However, shortly before the line was due to be handed back, Network Rail advised us that it was running behind schedule, partly to do with the weather, the beast from the east, I think it was called, and one of their wiring trains becoming derailed. This meant that the 450 to 500 drivers across 5 depots based in the northwest, serving the Liverpool City region and Cumbria in particular, had to train this section of line in a much shorter time scale. As well as this, we also had a driver rest day working agreement removed effectively, which meant that the additional resources that we would normally have to deliver training at a much more accelerated rate wasn't available to us. And so we found ourselves with a huge challenge to both operate the train plant and carry out this significant amount of training across our northwest portion of routes in a really short space of time. I think in week one, certainly at the end of week one, and midway through the second week of the new timetable, it was clear that it wasn't going to work. There was a huge number of cancellations. There was a lack of communication to advise our customers where the train plan was, where the cancellations were happening. It just wasn't tenable. So we took the decision, after a detailed consultation, we took the decision, a responsible decision, to pare that back and put in an interim temporary timetable. Now, the purpose of that was to effectively release the resource to carry out and catch up with the training and deliver a timetable that was robust and could be relied upon. What that meant was we removed 165 trains in total, which is around 6% of our overall train plan, 2,800 trains, and that effectively meant that we could plan and deliver a train plan without the random cancellations that were occurring on a regular basis. That said, it was still 300 more trains than what we were operating previously, so it was still an incremental improvement, even though prior to that the service just wasn't totally reliable. So against this backdrop, we are carrying out, in conjunction with the ORR, which commences next week, a full, clear, frank, deep dive into what's gone on. So that will be a full, wide-ranging industry investigation carried out by Professor Stephen Waister. That commences next week. That's completely independent, and the results will be known in September and then be published. So I'll make sure this committee has a copy of those findings. So the recovery plan, I've touched on this already, but the interim timetable was effectively put in place to give stability for our customers, to provide them with the certainty that the train that they come to catch is there, a reduction in last minute cancellations, which was a big one for me personally, because I had many text messages and phone calls from people on platforms where the departure screen was showing on time, then a minute later it was cancelled, which was completely ridiculous and completely unsatisfactory situation to be in. We wanted to ensure that customers could plan their journeys in confidence, could get to work on time, and get home on time, and effectively restore the confidence in the train service, operational objectives, as I've already touched on, was to stabilise the train plan and catch up with the outstanding driver training. Now, there was three strands of driver training that were going on whilst we were trying to deliver the train plan. The first portion was additional traction training as a result of the Manchester to Preston corridor not being electrified. What that meant was diesel trains, certain classes of diesel trains had to be moved into depots where they didn't have the competence, so there was a requirement for crews to learn class 158, for example, in Cumbria. There was the training needed around 500 drivers to learn a section of track between Blackpool and Preston, as well as the overlapping piece of work to learn Lime Street again. So as you know, Lime Street closure at the moment is all about resignalling and providing additional capacity. That resignalling requires the drivers to relearn that section of route. So there was potentially going to be an overlap of 1,000, two sets of drivers effectively being released to learn two pieces of work. So that would have been a massive risk, and to deliver a robust timetable, we needed to make the decision, take the decision that we did. So the recovery plan is, I've talked about this already. The current phase now is to stabilise what we're publishing and what we're delivering in terms of the train plan. Work through the training, so we've accelerated the training plan, we've refined it, so all the training to do with Blackpool and Liverpool is almost complete, which is great. So that's 500 drivers learning two routes, that is almost complete. So by the end of the month, when we look to reintroduce the service, there will be no training issues and no training requirement. The Lakes Line and Blackpool and Southport are three other routes that have been badly affected, as you know. So we've been working hard to ensure that the training requirements for the depots that operate in those parts of the world is also complete. What we're doing currently is reviewing an assessment of what the consolidated plan will look like on the 29th of this month. The plan is to reintroduce those 165 trains, so we are back to where we should be for the main timetable. We are taking a very careful approach to that decision, so we're going to go through it. We're currently going through it, should I say, line by line, assessing any residual risk by building and mitigation, so when we do reintroduce the services, it will be without any issues. So the interim timetable, this is a very quick summary of what it meant to this part of the world, the Northwest in general and the city region. We operate around 70 different routes right across the north. But because the majority of the training was for depots based in the Northwest, it meant that the routes that we needed to revise were also in the Northwest. So there are 11 routes shown there. The ones in red run into the Liverpool City region. So it's the Blackpool South Colne, it's the Preston to Wandsworth section that impacts obviously the Liverpool City region. We've got Southport, Wigan, Victorias, and of course the Liverpool, Wigan, and Liverpool Vic, as well as the Liverpool South Parkway to Manchester Oxford Road. What we did generally, there was a scaling back of services between 30% and 40%, and we reduced the Liverpool Wigan and Liverpool service through the blockade to one train per hour, which has worked well. As I said, once we've done the evaluation of how this timetable will look beyond the 29th of May, we will reverse that and reintroduce that 6% of the This is just really to give you an example of how bad the timetable was in the first 2 weeks in May, from May timetable being introduced. The green line, I'm sure you can see that clearly, that's the West region. For this part of the world, the cancellations are generally the yellow and the green. So we've gone from effectively early June, hemorrhaging 300 cancellations a day, which is unheard of, absolutely unsustainable. The drop there is when we introduced the new timetable, the interim timetable. So it peters down to in this graph to sort of a 30-40, it's down to a handful now. The residual training is, as I say, almost complete, so it will be just usual operational type incidents that cause cancellations beyond the 29th of July. So, I mean, that's a real sort of graphical image that, you know, it just proves that the timetable wasn't working. It was impossible to do both the training and the timetable. And we had to take a responsible decision, which we did, as unpalatable and difficult as that may be. So, I've talked about the 29th of July. Now, the 29th of July is Sunday when we are looking to reintroduce services as per the original main timetable. You'll be aware of the Lime Street resignalling work. There's no offer here from Network Rail today, but I can confirm that the programme is on track. The Northern train pre-route learning from Lime Street is also on track. And I believe the other operators that serve the Lime Street are also making good progress. There was a gauge clearance requirement for our new Class 323 EMUs to operate on the channels. That's a work in progress. If the gauge clearance doesn't occur, it will not affect the training plan as we have 319s already available and in operation on that route. So that would cause no delay to the reintroduction of services. Customer compensation, I'm sure you will have read. There's a couple of strands to this really. The first one, which is our biggest priority, is the compensation for our customers and passengers, particularly in the Liverpool City region. The map on the right, it's not very clear there, but effectively the yellow route lines are the routes that have been mostly affected, and it's those routes that will get the compensation. So Transport for the North and Department for the Transport announced details earlier this week. The details have been published on our website. And customers can also claim via that web page. Should point out that this scheme is over and above the industry delaying pay scheme. And this is over and above that. We've already, I think since the start of the franchise, compensated customers to the amount of £1.4 million via delaying pay. This is over and above that. There is £6 million being allocated to the compensation fund. Customers who have a season ticket, an annual season ticket, who were affected by the disruption, will get compensation for 4 weeks. Customers with weekly season tickets will get the weekly equivalent. And anyone who doesn't quite fit into that will be treated and reviewed on a case-by-case basis. So we went live at midnight last night. I think that the last check, we've had about 500 claims in already through our customer experience centre. The other element, which I know Steve Rotherham's been involved with, is the marketing for routes that have been badly affected. So with three main tourist routes within that map that are mostly affected, and those are Southport, Blackpool and the Lakes. There is a marketing fund, details of which will be announced in the mechanisms for local authorities and tourist boards to claim. That will be announced in more detail in due course. That will be managed by TFM, so you can expect an announcement in due course. December 18, so we've had May 18, so well. We'll have May 18 too at the end of July, which should go a lot better. December 18 was going to be the next timetable change with significant service improvements. Rail Delivery Group made a decision earlier this week and announced that we would have a May 18 rollover, so it would be the May timetable with some small tweaks and amendments which would effectively improve any shortfalls in the timetable that we put in, that was quickly and hastily introduced, and improve any peak time gaps, and there will be opportunities to tweak a few service groups as well. But predominantly it will be a rollover of the current timetable, and the big changes that should come in December will now roll forward to May 19. I think that the reason for this is exactly what I've already said, it's so that the industry can embed the timetable, make sure it's robust and resilient. We're putting the customers at the forefront of any decisions that we're making as we should. And to go ahead and try and introduce a timetable where certain bits of infrastructure have yet to be completed and are not yet confirmed would be the wrong decision. So we've taken the decision to roll forward then, and the December changes will come into effect in May 19. So I've gone through the reasons behind it, what we did about it, and what we're going to do about it, and how we're going to look after our customers, and how we're going to make sure that the future timetable is robust. I suspect you'll have a number of questions, so I'm happy to take those now, Chair, if that's okay.
Yeah, thanks, Craig. Very good. I've got Ron and Tony to start, but if you want to speak, can you put your hand up and keep it up until I've nodded at you? Okay, Ron first.
Yeah, 2 years ago. Integrated bus and rail. Have you made any progress on that? Can you give us a timetable to likely implementation of some joint offer of services between bus and rail?
Yes, thanks. Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think I stood here and talked about connectivity in the recent past. As you know, we've had quite a bit of infrastructure engineering work in this part of the world, both on the Mersey Rail network and on ours. And one thing that we were really keen to do was to bring our Arriva bus colleagues into our framework for providing replacement buses, first of all, both planned and ad hoc, particularly given the great job that they did in Liverpool when the slap track works were going on. We've utilised Arriva for special events to the city, as well as the recent closure of Lime Street. What we've also done, we are working with Mersey Travel, with our colleagues at Arriva Bus and St Helens Council, to really sort of develop an initial scheme at St Helens Central. So there is an Arriva Bus depot just a little bit further down the road from the station. What we're going to do, we're going to develop St Helens to be more of a transport hub, so it's promoting both bus and rail. We're talking about through timetables and promoting products that are available on both. So that will be almost a test case or a blueprint for what we want to do elsewhere on the network. We're doing something else in the northeast, very similar to that with our Arriva colleagues there. Once that's trial, we're not just going to stick with Arriva though, so if you look at the map I had up earlier, if you go north of Preston, we don't operate Arriva bus there, it's more stagecoach, and that's something that we've got the test case proven. We'll do that. We've done some additional work with Blackpool Transport recently, given the engineering work to Blackpool and Preston. We have developed a good working relationship with them, and they're keen to look at how we build in both rail, bus, and tram connectivity and remote products.
Thanks for that. What timescale are we looking at with the trial? And what we're looking at is through transport, so the seamless movement of people. So you get a train, you know, at the end of the day, the bus will be connected with the train. And that's what we're looking at. The connectivity is the important part. So the timetable of the bus is matched to the timetable of the train's arriving and the train did not. It's not beyond the written plan. It used to be done a long time ago. Around Berry movements, when Berry's came in, the buses were there, and people got on the bus and got off where we are. It's that type of thing that we're sure to. But it's okay saying we're trying it, but how long are you going to trial it for? How long do you like to be rolling it out? I understand that you've got part of the network stage, but the majority of the services, 80% of the world in the mid-city region are Arriva buses. And you have control by your master, Deutsche Bank, to make some significant decisions around how you join these things up and make that as a priority, not as an afterthought. What we're trying to do is make sure that the travelling public have the best travelling option they have.
just to be clear, the I guess where I was going to with the St Helens trial, that is more about promoting the bus and rail together. So from a customer point of view, they understand the connectivity and the joint timetables and the product.
What we do, obviously, it's easier to change bus timetables than rail timetables. Every time, we have two major timetable changes a year. We consult with all our local transport authorities, in this case Mersey Travel. So we share our rail plans and consult those in. And if there are any issues in terms of gaps in bus connectivity, that's the forum where we discuss those. I think we can do more. I think, you know, going forward for me, working with Mersey Travel, we should perhaps involve some of our bus colleagues in that timetable consultation.
Can I just once again come back? Once again, that what we've asked for in the past, that current driver's portal,
yeah.
We've asked the Arriva bus, Arriva trains, to talk to each other about how they can interconnect at a central point where the train stops. The train stops at the bus out of Parkway.
Yeah.
And a person gets off and waits 15 to 20 minutes for the bus. It's easy to manoeuvre the bus time. We don't have control over that as major travel. We only publish what the operators do. It's the operators, that's i.e. a Arriva bus, a Arriva, that have the ability to actually tear around the same point. We will join that GMPL, so a person has to see it as travel. And that's what we're trying to do, is that connectivity between bus and rail. And the easiest part to do is with the Arriva, because you are a Arriva, i.e. Arriva trains and Arriva bus.
Yeah. Okay. Point taken. I will take that away personally, and I will speak to my colleagues at Arriva bus. We need to identify where the issues lie, first of all, and I guess put that in priority order. I think there are good connections already, but there are areas where we can improve. So I'll say it all the way.
On that point, can I ask that you come back to us then in some time in the near future and explain how you're actually managing to implement it?
Happy to. Yeah, happy to.
Sure, that's great. Tony?
Thanks, Craig. You got your tin hat on?
There they
are.
You need your tin hat on for the year. Because obviously, what's occurred over the last couple of months is effectively a perfect storm, isn't it? You've got your timetable changes, your engineering on the line, and also you've had RMC action, strike action, labour action. So, there's been labour issues, and you've got your driver training as well. So, combine all them, you look at them and you think, there's going to be problems there. And effectively, there was. And now you've got to answer the questions in relation to how that all came about and what could you have done to avoid that. There's one particular thing that you could have done that we've insisted Mersey Rail do. Take a call by the horns and speak to the unions regarding the issues that they have. So therefore, your passengers there would know exactly what was going on. They would know that there could be a resolution down the line. That solved one problem, which was in your hands to do. The engineering work, probably out of your hands, you know, if points are going to be changed and so on and so forth, then that's, well, in particular, the labour issues regarding the staff, is in your hands. The driver training is also in your hands. So therefore, to sit down at the table and say, well, listen, what do we need to do to ensure that we don't let our passengers down? Now, I'd like to think that that is going to move forward at a pace, because that's one thing that you can resolve.
Yeah. I think, you're absolutely right. We're actually in talks earlier this week with RMC, and we're in talks again next week. Those were really positive conversations. I think the challenge that we had earlier this year was the preconditions really that the RMC were insisting on to come to the table and talk, i.e. they wanted us to guarantee two safety critical members of staff on the train before we talk to us. That was part of the discussion that we wanted to have, so we've overcome that now. We are at the table and having meaningful conversations, which absolutely, it's completely in our gift to plan and prepare for that. I think we did, but because of the things coming out of the left field with the infrastructure, it was last minute, and it meant that the knock-on effects of that meant we had to completely replan, which was a challenge, as I've just outlined. The Glaister review, which commences next week, will fully investigate every aspect of that, and there will be recommendations following the September report, which will also be published later in the year, to prevent this happening again. Next one,
I've got is John.
Thanks, Chair. So thanks, Craig. Thanks very much for your report. I'm sure you have got a tin hat on. Don't take any of these questions personally, but clearly we do have to ask them to hold you to account, really, or your organisation. First question, I've got three, actually, Craig. So first question is about Northern's communications being woeful during this time. That's probably an appropriate word to use. Why was there no prior warning to the Department of Transport for the North, local authorities and the travelling public? Why was there poor information for passengers at stations, and why was the engagement of the media so absent? And finally, on that particular item, is how has it been, if it has been, rectified? Because clearly we as an organisation, Mersey Travel and Transport Committee, have not really seen evidence or clear evidence of your communication strategy. So I'd just like to elaborate on that, Craig, would be grateful. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. I think that's what Charlie briefly in the slides. I think the biggest disappointment was customer comms, both in advance and on the day. The timetable didn't work. Trains weren't where they should be. Train crew completely out of place, and our customer information system simply couldn't cope with that. We recognised that early on, and that was what prompted the need to change the timetable. In the interim, while we were planning that timetable, we used every available channel to get more accurate information out there. We used social media platforms, as well as staff on the ground, but clearly that wasn't enough, and that was, you know, what prompted the need for the new timetable. I think in terms of information sharing to the media, I think, if I'm honest, we needed to take a step back and understand what the issues were that were causing it, while we planned the interim timetable. And as you may have seen, David did a number of television interviews and issued a number of press releases shortly after the interim timetable came into being, which outlined the issues that I've just explained and the reasons why we need the interim timetable. The stability that the interim timetable has brought, particularly in the Northwest, has been positive. We've been sharing that with our colleagues at Transport for the North on a daily basis, I'm sure Lee will know very well, Mersey Travel is very much part of Transport for the North, so we'll be keeping our transport authorities updated via that channel. And I think going forward, as I said, I keep referring to the Glaister review, but I think it's a really important piece of work, because all of our planning going forward, whether it be infrastructure development, timetable, planning and delivery, will be based around those findings, and there needs to be much more robust planning with, I think, more of a buffer as well as some of them, a bit more contingency. That's the right thing to do. Sometimes we're, you know, as an industry, we're really keen to make changes quickly, and if you make a lot of huge changes together at the same time, there's obviously more risk in the forward. So, as I say, when the report is published, we will share that with you.
Thanks, Craig. Just an addendum really to that one, I just come to my mind really. In terms of your social media strategy, how effective do you think that is? And going forward, do you think that needs to be improved?
Yeah, I mean, social media, it's a vital channel. A lot of people are also on Twitter and Facebook when they travel to and from work. We've bolstered our social media team, so it's covered much later and much earlier now. There's always room for improvement, and I think where we can do much more when we're out of this challenging situation, we can use that more as a promotional tool so we can promote products, market regions such as Liverpool, and work closely with the Liverpool City Region and the other authorities on joint schemes to grab carbon. Thinking the current situation is let's get the timetable right, get the service rate absolutely resilient, and then we can start talking about our modernisation scheme to deliver new trains, better stations, more services. I think just on that point, I perhaps should have put a slide in at the end. This franchise will deliver the biggest investment in rail that the North has seen. That is still our number one priority and focus. 2020 is the destination. We'll have a fleet of £500 million worth of brand new trains. The first one has arrived just down the road at Allerton. And we will be holding an event which you'll all be invited to come and have a look at it later this summer. So, a bit of promotion there.
Thank you, thanks for that. Second question is, under the Smart in the North programme, where will you be expanding smart ticketing in your local city region, particularly as this is something that's already been done on Mersey Rail?
Yeah, so the Walrus scheme is something that we partially support via digital. I've met with Mersey Travel to discuss how that's further rolled out. We're very keen to make sure that the product is right and is compatible with our own ticketing systems. There was a work stream, Smart in the North, which is led by Transport for the North. We detached one of our commercial team to be a member of that group, so we are fully embedded in the development of Smart Ticketing.
Pleased to hear you making progress on that. And final question for me, you'd be relieved to hear about that. What strategies have you put in place to ensure that this chaos does not happen again in the future? Now, you touched on this a little bit, but I just wonder if you could just develop it a little bit.
Yes. So, I think from our point of view, we are really keen to understand the recommendations made by Stephen Wester. That will touch on every element of operations, infrastructure, planning, but in terms of what we're doing currently, it's really focusing on delivering what we should be delivering. So to do that, we're doing an in-depth review of driver and conductor establishments of depot, so we ensure that we've got the right headcount to deliver the work that is allocated to that depot. If you have a differential there, you're not going to deliver a sustainable plan. So that review's underway. We're obviously working closely with our union colleagues to obviously get over the current dispute with the RMT, and as I said earlier, that's talks are ongoing. We're looking at how we can optimise our links and depot strategies, so where work is allocated in terms of routes. Is it in the right place? Is it something that we can do to make it more efficient and robust? So the whole operations and planning process will be reviewed by the Glacier Report, but we are doing it ourselves. We're not just sitting back and waiting for the independent review. You know, as a responsible operator, we're acting and we're making revisions.
Jerry, then
Gordon,
then Sue, and then Chris.
Jerry? Yeah. Thanks. Just an important question, I think, which is a good Northern are a subsidiary of Arriva, which is in turn a subsidiary of Deutsche Bahn. How have your parent companies supported Northern through this crisis? Have they given extra financial investment support, for example?
Yeah. So you're absolutely right. We're part of the Arriva Group and Deutsche Bahn are our parent company. In terms of support,